refuse to give ourselves to principles, we cut short our own lives.
We've been looking at the manifesto of the kingdom. We're going to look at the third policy statement. His first policy statement is that you shouldn't be economically poor. Jesus was sent to make sure you're rich. Second policy statement, you shouldn't have a broken heart. Hallelujah. Your heart must be mended in accordance with the purpose of God. And so I encourage you, if your heart is broken, there is enough healing, enough strength to bring a restoration. And if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior, then you need to get to know him, and he will do you good. And then the third we're going to look at this morning, or should I say this afternoon, is freedom for the captives. His purpose is that every child of God, everybody born of God, should not live in captivity. The Bible says a woman who suffered a spirit of infirmity and was all twisted came to Jesus. And the thing is that Jesus healed her. But there were observers around, hypocrites, who didn't like the idea that Jesus had healed her on the Sabbath day. So they started criticizing. But Jesus made a very powerful statement. And upon this statement, I'll develop the rest of the thesis this afternoon. And that is, she was a daughter of Abraham and therefore deserves to be healed. He made that powerful statement to tell you and I that because you are a child of the king, nothing should hold you into captivity. Nothing should stop you from prospering. Nothing should stop you from being healed. He said, I wish above all things that you live in good health, even as your soul prospers. 1 Corinthians 4, 14 to 21, for time's sake, I'll just dwell on the 20th verse. It says, for the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. I repeat, the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. So when we come to the kingdom like this, it's not talk. Hallelujah. I say it's not what? Talk. Talk is cheap. Empty barrels make the most noise. Glory to God. Amen. There must be a balance of the word and of the power of the Holy Spirit. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. That is what the Bible says, the latter killeth. Amen. So you just going word wouldn't help you. And you going power wouldn't help you. You need a true balance of the word and the power of the demonstration of the power of God. Jesus said, I came to set the captives free. Let's just put some groundwork here. Who is in captivity? Number one, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior, as for you, dear, you are gone. Hallelujah. You need Christ. But then after you become born again, you become one of his own. Nothing should hold you captive. You should be free to worship, free to give, free to love, free to go about your business, free to do what God has called you to do. And therefore, if anything holds you back in performing that, you are in captivity. And this afternoon, anybody in captivity will be loose in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Not because you come from a good home, not because you are handsome or pretty, but because of the work of the cross. Because he died on the cross. And I like a particular statement Jesus made when he was on the cross. He shouted, "It is finished." But there's a key thing there. He said, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? Father, Father, why have thou forsaken me?" The reason is that there is so much problem with humanity. There is so much problem, and God himself had to compromise in many things. For instance, the Bible says that in the Olden Testament, people started living in certain ways, and he allowed it. Jesus would say that Moses allowed divorce because of the word, the hardening of your heart, and God allowed it. Hallelujah, because Moses allowed it. Jesus would say, in the beginning, it was not so, but I allowed it to be so because of the nature of your heart. The Bible says our heart is so hard, like stone. And at the end of the day, what God wants to do for us and work through us because of our heart, he would not do or he cannot do. And in all this, he compromises in a way to say that, you know what, I give you grace. I give you grace. But when you give your life to him, he gives you salvation. The word salvation is soteriology, which simply means that you must have complete protection, wholeness, you must have provision, you must have safety, you must have prosperity. Now this word salvation is all this rolled into one. So when you give your life to Jesus and you say, "I am saved," that salvation you are claiming that is not complete until you see all these things happen in your life. Amen. Because a lot of us, when we become born again and we confess Christ, we think that is it. And the rest we're going to experience in heaven. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid down somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from what? And I can't feel at home in this world anymore because you're a failure. Hallelujah. Amen. When you are a failure, you want a way of escape. But the fact is that the reason why God didn't kill you when you became born again is that he wants you to remain here and make a difference in somebody else's life. Amen. So then he gives us a policy statement that everybody who is called of God must be free. And he keys this particular scripture into Jeremiah 29. Let's read Jeremiah 29. Glory to God.
Jeremiah 29, verse 10. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my gracious promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring back from captivity. I will gather you from the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile.
Hallelujah. This is Jeremiah writing to the people of God who have gone into captivity in Babylon under the strong arm of oppression of Nebuchadnezzar. And Nebu has been treating them terribly bad. But they needed to know the mind of God concerning their lives. And so Jeremiah writes from Jerusalem, the city of peace, to the people under the captivity of Nebuchadnezzar. And the Bible said that they were so much in pain that they stopped worshiping. Like some of us do. When we are sick, that is why we say we don't come into church. When things are not going well, that's why we stop coming to church. And funny enough, when things are going well, we'd rather come to church. And you realize that shouldn't be the, shouldn't be the opposite. But if anything at all, shouldn't it be the opposite? Hallelujah. Glory to God. We turn to, and that is what happened to them. And the Bible said, their musical instruments, they hung on the poplars. For they said, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, we wept, King James. Yea, we wept. When those that send us into captivity required of us a song. And we said, how can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? But my brother, you got to sing the Lord's song in a strange land. Hallelujah. Where you don't know your bread is coming from, where you don't know your left from your right, you need a stronger hand. You need a power from the on high to show you what to do. So when you are in a strange land, that is where you sing the Lord's song. Hallelujah. When the doctors have said that cancer is going to kill you, that is where you sing the Lord's song. When they have said that they're going to repossess your house, that is why you sing the Lord's song. When they said that the business is going into liquidation, that is why you sing the Lord's song. Hallelujah. When you are thrown into a strange land, that is where you sing the Lord's song. And trust me, when you sing the Lord's song, those powers that want to stop the glory of God over your life, they will scatter. But the people of Israel didn't understand that. Rather, they hang their musical instruments. They said, we are not going to sing the Lord's song. We don't want to sing the Lord's song. So Jeremiah writes a very powerful letter to them, and he tells them, this is what the Lord is saying. I, the Lord, knows the plans I have for you. Number one, plans to do what? Prosper you. So remember, this is not the gospel according to the world. This is not the gospel according to your uncle who hates you. This is not the gospel according to those who sit in criticism of you. This is coming from your maker. This is his manifesto. This is what he designed for you. I don't care what anybody else thinks. I know Jehovah who created me has plans for me. And his plan for me is to do what? Prosper. I didn't write the Bible. Hallelujah. His plan for me. In other words, he is working. You know what? Anytime you use the word plan, it means that somebody is doing something. When you're building a house, the architect has the plan. So he's working according to the plan. And he tells the builders, put the foundation this deep. He tells them, use this kind of block. Use this engineering block. For a starter block, you don't use this kind of block, hollow block. You use that block. And it goes on, it gives them detail. But he has a master plan. So God calls you. And he said, Patrick, my plan is to prosper you. My plan is to make sure that even though you were born in humble circumstances, by the time you are 20, this is what you should achieve. The time you are 40, that is what you should achieve. And I came to announce to somebody that God has you inscribed in his hand, and the plan of God for your life will be fulfilled. Am I talking to somebody? I heard only 3 people. Am I talking to somebody? I heard only 5 people. Am I talking to somebody? I heard only 10 people. Somebody give the Lord a shout. I know the plans I have for you. What are the plans? Number one is to prosper you. Number two is that plan is to give you hope and give you future. So let us look at that and deal with it one after the other. Who is speaking here? This is the Lord, Yahweh, the self-existing one. All-sufficient, eternal God, the creator of the universe. You see, if you don't know who you're dealing with, you can make big mistakes. Are you understanding that? You got to know that you are dealing with the King of Kings. Jeremiah only declared the word, but the word was coming from Jehovah. A lot of times, we don't know who we're dealing with. And so we take things for granted, and so we don't see our captivity. Some time ago, I had a very privileged opportunity to be one and one with a very powerful president. And whilst we were there, after having a chat and everything, he said, I should pray for him. And he gave me his head to lay hands. I didn't do that. Immediately, it dawned on me, this is the president of a whole nation. There is spiritual protocol.
if I'm praying deliverance or I'm ushering him, the Bible says that don't be hasty in laying hands. Even though he gave me his head willingly, I just held him and we pray. Because laying off of hands has a spiritual implication a lot of us don't understand. Glory to God. You should know who you're dealing with. It dawned on me that if I do something wrong, you'll be in the news. If I acted inappropriately, what I'm trying to convey to you is this, that anytime God says something and you are finding a problem dealing with it, begin to see who you are dealing with. He is Yahweh. He is Yahweh. That word Yahweh is the same word that is translated Jehovah. He is self-existent. When we say self-existent, he doesn't need breath from anyone. He creates his own breath. And he executes his own breath. He is Yahweh. He is self-sufficient. In other words, if he is thirsty, he creates his own water. If he is hungry, he creates his own food. If he needs money, he creates his own money. If you are hungry, you need to go and buy food. If you need money, you need to go and work. Am I talking to somebody? If you need a house, you need to go and build. But if he needs a house, he speaks into being. He just declares it. Let there be a house, and there is a house. Let there be the wind, and there is the wind. Let there be light, and there is light. He is self-sufficient. He can do all things. All the money you see in the Bank of England, every cow you see on the hill, everything belongs to him. This is the kind of God you are dealing with. Yahweh, all sufficient. Yahweh, you know what? And that Yahweh name, Oshebro Shatabasa, let me teach. That word also means a blank check. It means a blank check. That word also means, what do you want me to be for you? So he sends Moses, and he says to Moses, go to Pharaoh, and go and tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And then Moses looks at him and he says, sir, who should I say sent me? And he said, go tell him, I am. Hello. Go tell him, I am. And then he says, what does that mean? He says, I am who? I am. That is enough. Then he begins to unravel the mystery. And he says that to you and to every child I have, I am. Do, 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 ti, do. So then you got to put in there what you want to put in there. So if you are sick, he said, I am your healer, your Rapha. If you need a shepherd, he said, I am your role. If you need bosom to nourish you, I am your El Shaddai. So as a matter of fact, the Jehovahistic name of God is just there to determine for you, what do you want me to be? And because I am all sufficient, I create my own path. I call in my own food. I don't need anybody. Remember, if I have descended and I've told you that you are my friend, that I have blessed you, that I walk with you, you got to be so excited. He said, I am the all-sufficient one. You got to know who you're dealing with. A lot of times you don't know who we're dealing with. And we treat God anyhow. And for me, it saddens my heart. Because if you look into your life, the things that you ought to have achieved by now, If only you understand that Jehovah God is your all-sufficient one. He is your Jehovah Roy, Jehovah Melchizedek, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah El Elyon, Jehovah Sabaoth, and I like that one. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is the Lord, or the captain of the army of God's people. Hallelujah. He shows up, and that makes him the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Glory to God. He is the King of the jungle. And a lot of times we find ourselves in the jungle. There is a jungle out there. But be assured, I said be assured, that when you find yourself in the jungle, the captain of the jungle, the chief of the jungle, oh Shabbos, Shandaraba. Hallelujah. And do you know how lions operate? Lions operate this way. Anytime they determine a pride, they wee. And they determine their territory by that. And anything that enters that territory, they deal with it. Am I talking to somebody? In the same way, he remains the Lion of the tribe of Judah. When he locates you, he wheels around you. Hallelujah. And anything that tries to come into your arena, anything that tries to fight you, anything that tries to stand you, he just go, rah. This afternoon, may the Lord rah on your behalf. Am I talking to somebody? Jeremiah said, that saith the Lord. He uses the word Yahweh. Yahweh. He said, Yahweh is speaking. He says, I am the all-sufficient one. I am the all-sufficient one. I am the Ancient of Days. I am the Alpha and the Omega and everything in between. He said, it is me speaking. What is he saying? He said that I prosper you. Now listen, I don't know about you, but anytime anybody promises me something, the first thing I do is evaluate the person. That is why I always say that I have a problem with Eve's account in the garden. So I've come to the conclusion that the first animals that God created, he spoke. Seriously. Even though the Bible doesn't categorically state it. Because if me, I'm standing there, and a snake. You know, I'm standing by a tree, and a snake came. Shoo. Hello, Shadi. Forget about what the snake is saying. You are not supposed to talk. you get into your garden and then you see a goat there. And the goat goes, hello. Will you be listening to the goat? Hallelujah. You're going to run. Are you getting my point? You see, God is amazing. Hallelujah. He is amazing. He doesn't say things for saying sake. You got to examine who you're dealing with. If somebody told me, I'm going to give you something, I'm going to do something, first I examine. I look at what you've achieved in your life. I look at your ability to perform that which, unless God speaks direct to me, that even though I can't see the evidence, he's going to do it, then I take his word for it. Are you understanding that? Where I come from, there's an adage that says that if Mr. Nakedness says he's going to give you something to wear, listen to his name. The man is called Nakedness. He doesn't even have what to wear himself. Are you understanding that? And then, God gave us these brains to use. And somehow we believers don't use it. We think it is against God. No, when God gives you a specific instruction and you use your brain against it, that is when it's against God. But we got to use it. Are you getting my point? You find a man you are interested in, you love the man and everything. I mean, the man hasn't worked for 20 years. You getting my point? He holds a British passport and hasn't worked for 20 years. For 15 years, hasn't worked. Been on the door consistently. And there are people who have come into the country who don't even have papers. And they have worked hard. They've built houses. They've done stuff. And they don't even have a stay in their country. And the person has a British passport. Nothing. But I love him. We don't evaluate things. You've got to be able to look at stuff. The person says that, I will make you feel like a queen. Run! Hallelujah. Run! Tell him, take your queen. And your prince and princesses all. Glory to Jesus. You got to look at it. So you have to examine who you're dealing with. We are dealing with the awesome God. Hallelujah. I can trust him any day. You see, Jesus worked in a way that is so beautiful. You know, when he was promising us heaven, he actually demonstrated for us. That is why I said that you cannot claim to go to heaven if you don't have a heaven experience here. That's why I said, let the kingdom come. He wants us to experience it here. Are you understanding it? People are lazy, who don't want to do anything with their life. They're saying, this earth is not my home. It is your home. It is your home. Succeed here. Make it happen here. Because the kingdom has already come. Glory to God. Let it happen to you here. Walk in it. And then when the transition comes also, you go and then you enjoy over there. You got to know the God you are dealing with. You got to know the God you're serving. And know something. He created the earth. He created everything within. And he is self-sufficient, like I said. And he can make grace abound on you. But the point is that he said, I have the plans. But unfortunately, because we have been gone, we have been thrown into captivity, he has to now outwork the plan. And that is his manifesto. He said, if you are in the captivity of the devil, I came to work the plan. So the plan will be executed. He says to them, the 70 years you will come out of Babylon. I will establish you. I will do all those things. So you have to be able to understand what I am doing in your life. So he tells them, build houses. Build houses. Marry. Give your children into marriage. He said, because you are not coming out of Babylon now. For I know the plans. Hallelujah. Because sometimes we go into a particular realm and we define it as captivity. But in God's eyes, it is not captivity. It is a means of growth. He must allow certain things into your life to toughen you so that then when the real blessing comes, you can be able to handle it. That is what we call Christian suffering. Now, Christian suffering is not there to kill you. It is there to toughen you. It is there to prepare you for your grace and glory. And God spoke to them that 70 years you will be there. And 70 years is not easy. It's about almost two generations. So he said, settle. Some of them rebel against God. They will not settle. They will not buy houses. They will not do all those things because they are in captivity. And God is saying that, no. Go settle. Live in there. Buy houses, do stuff. So Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, all those key guys who understood God and knew the plan of God, gave themselves into it. Some of you came into this country, God told you, settle. You said, no, I'm not settling. Are you understanding that? So you don't eat well, you don't dress well. Meanwhile, you've built a whole big mansion. Back in Nigeria, back in Ghana, back in Australia, back in the Caribbean, wherever. And some houseboys enjoying it. And your life here is terrible. Live in one shack, one bedroom place. Share three bedroom with five people. You have to queue for the toilet. Meanwhile, you have powerful mansion. Anytime your houseboy hears you are coming, he cleans the whole place and everything. And then when you come, yes, Amasa. But that is it. He said, you have been thrown into a world where God is still in charge. Sometimes the situation we go through, we don't see God in it. But listen, if you're truly a child of God, and you know how big your God is, Elijah said he answered by fire. Glory to God. So whatever the situation and circumstance, he said, when you go through the water, I will be there with you. You go through the fire, I will be there with you. He said, the fire will not burn you, neither will the water will drown you. I, Jehovah God, will be your red God. You should just go on, I will be with you. But you see, those who understood the plan, it was only them that enjoyed. Like Daniel. Daniel will go to the king and serve the king. Did not challenge the king. Darius was the hidden king. Daniel actually served, I think, three or four kings, emperors. He started from the time of Nebuchadnezzar, from the Babylonian kingdom, the Persian kingdom, the Persian kingdom, up until Darius' time. And the guy was so powerful. He was a governor. He didn't criticize. He would be asked to come and fetch water or serve the king. He wouldn't even say that the king, you are hidden, which some of us do, because your boss is hidden. But Sunday message, I'm afraid even thinking about it. How God should ask ravens to feed Elijah. We'll deal with it later. Because there are some ravens God has selected to bring you bread. They are unlikely candidates. Hallelujah. There are people sitting next to you going, Sabra, Sabra. They will not give you a brass farthing. But there are some ravens out there. There are certain people. God. Darius didn't care about God. He set himself as a God himself. And finally they said they should worship him. They should bow down to him. They should do all those things. But you know what happened? It was Daniel who defiled it. And because Daniel made such an impact on the king, did not judge him once. He don't say that, hey, you sleep with a lot of women. You're gay, you're lesbian, you're a drunkard, you are this. He said, once I'm working in the courts, it has nothing to do with the lifestyle of the king. He said, I should serve the king as unto the Lord. And that is exactly what he did, because he understood prophecy. That God said, settle down. You are not going to Jerusalem now. Settle down. Buy houses. Marry. Give your children into marriage. And the Bible says when he was thrown into the dungeon, it was the same king. I mean, the king should have been angry, because what Daniel did was against his persona. But it was the king that could not sleep the whole night. It was the king that was pacing around his balcony until dawn, and he called for the chariots. And he said, let's go. Went to the place, and he shouted Daniel's name. Daniel! Daniel! Has the God whom you serve faithfully delivered you? He said, live forever, O king. Even though it was the king's decree that he was thrown in there, he said, he blessed the king. He said, live forever, O king. Yes, the God whom I serve daily has delivered me from the lions. He knows the God he is serving. Captives must be delivered. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He said, I know the plans. So now if he knows the plans, and like a master architect, he is working with you, then what then is the problem why things have delayed? The first problem we have in working with this manifesto is our mentality. You need to change. I have seen people who have PhDs, but because they were poor, born into poor environments, their mind is still poverty mentality. Five children slept in the same room, on the same bed. When they are asleep, somebody's leg in somebody's mouth. Somebody's bum in somebody's face. They grew up in that environment. Are you understanding it? So when they grew up, even though education came in, still, the mentality is somebody's bum in somebody's face. Terrible. And we grow with that. So we are not able to change our minds. We can't even see God, so we question him all the time. And we are not able to evaluate where we are. As we deal with the number one situation, look at this. It says that I have the plans. Let's work the plans. Are you understanding that? It says work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. The fear there is reverence for God. The fear there is knowing who God is. Hallelujah. Then you got to work it out with your mind. Paul puts it in Romans 12. He said that renew your mind. Because if you don't renew your mind, you cannot approve what God's will is. Romans 12, 1 following. He said, be transformed by the renewal of the mind. The Greek word there is metamorphose, out of which you get an English word metamorphosis. And it is a system by which a butterfly develops from the larva state to the cocoon or whatever they call it, and then finally to a beautiful butterfly. And what happens in that process is that if a butterfly is struggling to come out of his cocoon or whatever it is, and struggling, and you don't know, and you pick the butterfly, and you help the butterfly out, you either kill the butterfly or the butterfly comes out disabled. And that is what sometimes we do. We don't allow ourselves to go through that process. If you first bake a cake, outside will be brown. But when you put your hands in it, it will still have that liquid in there. It's not complete. We've got to come to our senses. Glory to Jesus. You've got to straighten the mind. What do you see? What do you see, number one, about your God? And number two, about you? Write it down. Confess it. When I became a believer, that is what I did. I had 7 for 21 things that the person that fathered me in Christ taught me. And he blessed me, and he's blessed me to today. 7 things to confess every day. 7 things to avoid every day. And 7 things to do every day. 7 things to confess every day. And I will confess it. I had it in my bedroom. I will look at it before I go out. And I'll say one of those things that be kind to somebody in a day. Give to somebody in a day. If it's coming up to 12 o'clock and I've not given to anybody, I will find an orange, a banana, or chocolate or something and go out and give it to somebody. Because I realize that in our life, we are not brought up to be generous. We are all selfish by nature. So you don't just sit down and expect the selfishness to go. You have to be proactive in working yourself. And as you do that, you adjoin yourself to the plan of God for his purposes to be fulfilled in your life. You've got to train yourself. You've got to also confess who you are every day so you can hear it. When Paul, God wrote to the churches in Revelation, you realize that he said, to the church in Thyatira, write. To the church in Ephesus, write. To the church in this, write. But did he say that when he gets there, they should read it? No. He said they should hear. So all the churches, they'll bring it and they will hear. The key word is you hearing. And sometimes you've got to sit down and rattle God's word. The prophecies about your life that you've written it down. Read it to your hearing. Confess it every day. For confessing brings possession. Let them call you man. I am born again to win again. I am making it in life. No weapon formed against me will prosper. Everything that rises against me, is condemned. Begin to confess it. Every day, they tell you that you will not make it. Tell yourself, I will make it. I will make it. I see myself sitting in that chair. I see myself traveling to that place. I see myself working the business. Are you understanding that? You wake up in the morning, if it is a business you want to do, see yourself in it. Speak to God about it. Confess it every day. You realize that he is working it through for you. Captivity starts from here. Hallelujah. It starts from here. And then Paul goes on to say that when you have now been able to metamorphose, then you will be able to ascertain what God's will is. In other words, what God's plan is. Then you can see. The fact that you are failing doesn't mean that God fails people. And please, church, stop defining God by your personal experiences. I repeat, stop defining God by your personal experiences. You heard me talk about Asaph, and I'll say it again. Asaph was the personal director, music director of David. Now, David was the top musician of his day. So if he had a music director, then you should know how prolific and powerful the music director was. The Bible said all his service, he didn't see God. And he looked at his master and how his master began and how God has blessed his master. He had his own gold mine. The man was filthy rich, permit the language. So rich, because God's blessings maketh rich and adds no sorrow. Asaph looks at it and he goes crazy about it. And he said, whoa, I'm almost sleeping. All these non-believers are making it. Driving big cars and doing all that kind of stuff. And me who have God, I cannot see that in my life. The Bible said he kept on because that was his mentality. Until he came into the sanctuary. Hang on a minute. You live in the sanctuary. You play in the sanctuary. You are always on the piano in the sanctuary. So what did the scripture mean by that? The scripture simply means that all this time he was performing. He had not renewed his mind concerning who his God was and who his God is. He was performing. And a lot of times we perform. Are you understanding it? We speak Christianese. We know how to say the shandas and the hallelujahs and everything. Hello, brother. Praise God. Oh, I feel the spirit. We love that. Glory to God. We love the jerking and the shaking. It's okay. Continue. That's fine. We love that. We like the norm. But we don't go into it. And he said the day he had his mind renewed, he properly entered the sanctuary. That day, things changed. Prosperity began to flow. Provision began to flow. Because he changed that mind. Jeremiah says that, I have plans for you. How can you get into the plan? A lot of us are in a captivity of sin. We need to first change our mind. Do you know and believe that Jesus Christ hung on the tree that you might be healed? Is it not just what pastor have said or you heard on TV or read somewhere? But you really believe and believe. Are you understanding it? You know in your heart, like the Syrophoenician woman who was bound, whose daughter was bound, ran to Jesus, knelt at the feet of Jesus, and he said, Jesus, please, I need healing for my child. Help my child. Jesus wouldn't bother. She went on, please, I need some help. Jesus looks at him and he says that I cannot take the children's bread and toss it to dogs. That is an insult too. If you can permit me to use that language. It is like an American white calling an American black the N-word. That is how terrible. Because the Jews called the Gentiles dogs. So you can imagine, Jesus Christ, you should know better. You are God. How can you also insult me that way? But this woman had her mind renewed. He knows that God cannot make mistakes. I feel like preaching this. She has her mind renewed. She knows God cannot make mistakes. Are you understanding that? And even if God makes mistakes, he alone has the power to rectify it. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. So she looks at Jesus and he said, Jesus, I'm not going to take offense at what you said. As a matter of fact, even dogs do eat of the crumbs that falls off the master's table. Oh, Jesus looks at her and Jesus said, I have not seen such a faith in Israel. You know what he's saying? He said that my own people who should have this level of belief don't even have it. It takes a foreigner. That's what happens in church. Other people come in and they get blessed. And some people who have been on the pew for 20 years are still on the pew complaining. That's what happens. He said, look at this woman. And immediately the healing came. And I always say, if the crumbs that fell off the table heals the woman's child, how much more the bread that is on the table? For the Bible says, he prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Captive daughter of Syrophoenician, free because of the mentality. You know also about the widow. The man, not Zarephath, Elisha's widow, the woman that had the woman that had no children, and Elijah prayed for her to have a child. You know about that story. How can I, Look at the mentality she also had. Captives. The first captivity is your mind. Take it out. Renew it. Hallelujah. She will see Elisha pass by every day or every week or every month. How often I've forgotten. And one day he said, I have to build this woman a house. Very rich, rich woman. I agree with the husband. They did a penthouse up in the building, decorated it, put in a bed, table, everything. Do you know something? It wasn't a guest room. It wasn't a guest room that Elisha can also use. It was specifically for the man of God. And anytime the man of God wasn't there, it's locked. Nobody goes in there. You understand? Mentality. Look at how he thinks. A lot of us, we have come from traditions that are still fighting us. Families that are still fighting us. Words that has been spoken. That those who spoke those words are gone. And we are still grappling with those words. He said to herself, I need to bless this woman of God. Because when I bless a man of God, I get a blessing too. So you know what happened? She got a child. You know the story already. I'm not going to go into it. But the key thing is the mentality. And the child dies. So she realizes that God cannot give anything good and take back. It was imprinted on her mind. She believed it in her soul. And she didn't know how it's going to happen. But somehow that child ain't going to die. Captivity must go. Your mind must be delivered. You must renew it from today. Hallelujah. If you don't know how to do it, go to the seaside. Get a few things that should help you. And then rattle it every day. And let something happen to it. Glory to God. The Bible said when he went to see glory to Jesus. She took the child, put her in the room, locked it, and went to see the man of God. When he got near the man of God, and the man of God also saw her coming from a distance, the man of God told the servant, go and ask her if it is well. Some of us will become history tutors. No, it is not. No, it is not. This. No. The moment Gehazi shouted, is it well with your husband? She shouted, it is well. Is it well with you? He said, it is well. Is it well with your son? She shouted, it is well. Because she knows that Yahweh, who gave her the child, has the power and authority to resurrect the child. What can we say also about Abraham, the man? God told Abraham, you're going to have lots of children. He said, oh my goodness, lots of children. He said, yes. And he said, I need your mind to be renewed. Because what you see renews your mind. So he said, come out of your house. And he said, lift up your head. Look into the skies. And begin to count. I said, are you counting? He said, yes, but this is a plenty. He said, yes, you can stop there. That is how your descendants are going to be. Give him the vision in order for the mentality to change. What you see in a man is what you get. If you see the man as wicked, you will get a double dose of his wickedness. When he's been smiling at you, you will see it as a killer smile. Hallelujah. But when you see him as good, are you getting my point? Even when he acts evil against you, God shields you out of it. What do you see? The mentality is the first thing to come out of captivity. It's a freedom for the captives. What about Jesus and the disciples? Oh boy, I thought I'd be able to finish freedom for the captives today. We'll continue another time. Shall we rise?
Our mission is raising overcomers, setting the captives free. Freedom Center International is here to support you in every step that you take with the Word of God as you seek spiritual and emotional wholeness. And we hope you've been blessed by today's message. Worship with us at 38 Upper Wickham Lane, Welling, Kent, DA16 3HF, or give us a call on 0207 277 8700. You can also visit us online at fcichapel.org. And remember, there is progress in freedom.